Hey everybody, it's the 80s Slasher Librarian. Exciting news, the Slash Tracks Network is on Cameo now. For $10, you can get a video from me and Alex, Master Evil, Freddy, even the Rodeo Clown from Slash Tracks. We're looking forward to hearing from you. We can do a happy birthday video, advice, anniversary, just whatever you want us to say. Send us the money, we'll say the words, we'll have a good time doing it. Keep it scary, and pleasant dreams! Freddy vs. Ash, the fan novel by A.S. Eggleston. Chapter 13. Ash looked at the watch that wrapped around his left wrist. It was 3:08 a.m. He had now reached the apartment building and pulled over by the street. The building was 3 stories tall, with concrete stairs that led to the front door. There wasn't anything particularly grand about it, except for the line of shrubbery surrounding the building. There was no light coming from it, not even the one above the front door. It was too late in the night. Everyone had gotten out of Ash's Oldsmobile seconds after he stopped. All 5 of them walked over to him before he could drive away. Cooper leaned over to face him. Ash promptly rolled his window down. Cooper placed his hands on the door. "So, oh wise one," said Cooper. Ash quickly turned to Cooper. His lips smirked and his eyebrows scrunched together. "Haven't heard that one in a while." "You sure Freddy's the one pulling the strings here?" "Take my word for it, kid," he said. "Okay," Cooper tried not to sound irritated from being called kid all the time. "Any words of advice before we meet our doom?" "Yeah," the friendly smirk had left Ash's face. He was now utterly serious. "Don't fall asleep." As soon as the words left his mouth, Ash put the car in gear and drove off.
Hail to the king, baby.
Everyone had settled in Evelyn's apartment, which was just down the hall from Cooper's. They saw each other every day. Every morning they would walk down the hall together as they left for work. Those 13 months of her life had been perfect and happy, until now. Before, her biggest concern was paying rent and getting to work on time. Now she just hoped that she and her friends weren't going to die. The apartment was small and underfurnished. Everyone was forced to take refuge in the tiny living room. The walls were a warm beige color and decorated with a few picture frames mounted above an old ratty couch. A thick, fuzzy blanket was draped along the right side of the couch. In front was the television that was held up by a small entertainment center that Cooper had helped her build when she first moved in. It didn't take very long to assemble, since most of the parts were made out of plastic. Most of that part of the wall had been covered with bookshelves. The room had been plastered with so many books that they almost served as decorations. In the corner was a very small stereo held up by a table. Various CDs were strewn around it. Avenged Sevenfold, Megadeth, and her favorite, Black Sabbath's first album. Stephen and Jill sat on the futon while Faith sat on the chair next to it. Cooper was too restless to stay still. He stood back behind the wall, occasionally pacing back and forth through the living room. Jill had just finished filing down her nails after picking at them earlier. She worriedly touched her hair and looked at her own bloodshot eyes. Stephen waved his hand in front of her to get her attention. "Hello," he teased. "What's wrong?" "I think I'm losing my hair," she said. "You know, from the stress." She rubbed her eyes. "And look at my eyes, they're all red." "Oh, you're fine," he assured her. He pointed at her face. "You just got that one ugly thing right there. What's that called?" "Oh, right, your face." Jill slapped away his hand from her view. "Oh, real nice, bro," she said. "Do I tell you that you look like a douchebag?"
"Yeah,"
Stephen confirmed. Jill laughed. "Okay, so at least I'm being accurate." Stephen quickly put Jill in a headlock and started rubbing her hair.
"Quit it!"
Jill put her hand on his face and tried to push him away.
"I'll knock the bleach right off your hair," Stephen said, muffled from Jill's hand smushing the side of his face.
"So are we really doing this?" Faith asked after not speaking since being in the car. "Not sleeping, just staying up for, what, days?"
"I guess we have to," Cooper answered.
"Well," Jill broke out of Stephen's headlock, "I don't know if I can do that."
"Yeah," said Cooper, "me neither."
"We'll just sleep in shifts," Faith proposed. "Just to be safe, if one of us looks like we're having a nightmare, we'll wake each other up." Cooper realized that Evan had been in her room for a long time. He worried about her.
"I'm going to check on Evelyn," said Cooper.
She had changed out of her jeans and wore a pair of flannel shorts. She sat with her legs crossed on her bed, reading from one of her books. It was one of her favorites, The Raven by Edgar Allan Poe. She needed to read something to calm her nerves. Evelyn wanted to find out firsthand if Freddy was real, but was worried about what might happen if she dived right in. "I need to know if Ash is telling the truth. If you're real, you'll show yourself to me tonight." Evelyn raised her head.
"Who is it?"
she asked.
"Can I come in?"
asked Cooper. Evelyn set the book down, rushed to the door, and opened it.
"Are you okay?"
he asked.
"Yeah, I'm fine. Why do you ask?"
"Well, you were gone for a while. I was just checking."
"What are you doing in here?" he asked.
"I was reading."
Evelyn walked to grab her book and sat down on the edge of the bed. Cooper sat beside her.
"Why'd you change?" he asked, regarding her clothes.
"Because the pants I was wearing are covered in blood."
"Right,"
he remembered, trying not to sound embarrassed.
"What are you reading?"
"The Raven by Edgar Allan Poe." He scrunched his eyebrows in confusion.
"Why?"
"Seemed fitting, I guess," she explained. "Here, listen. Deep into that darkness, peering, long I stood there wondering, fearing, doubting, dreaming, dreams no mortals ever dared to dream before. But the silence was unbroken, and the stillness gave no token, and the only word spoken was the whispered word, Lenore. This I whispered, and an echo murmured back in the word, Lenore. Merely this, and nothing more."
Cooper gazed at her, confused.
"Are you trying to give yourself nightmares?"
"No," she lied. "I just felt like I should read something to calm my nerves."
"Why'd you come back here alone, then?"
"I wanted to get away from everyone for a few minutes," she answered. "With everything that's happening today, it's overwhelming."
"I know it is,"
Cooper began to inform her about the plan. He took her by the hand and gave her a comforting smile.
"Speaking of which, we decided we're going to sleep in shifts tonight."
"Yeah, that sounds like a good idea. Now."
He helped her up to her feet and led her out of the door.
"Come on, you need to be out here with everyone. I know it sounds weird, but if what Ash said had some truth to it, I feel like you need to be where I can see you at all times."
She agreed.
"I feel the same way."
Cooper grabbed the blanket from her couch.
"Okay, guys," he announced. "Evelyn's going first. We'll wake her up in an hour and move on to the next person."
As Evelyn laid down, Cooper gently covered her with the blanket. He pushed a string of her dark hair away from her face and smiled at her.
"I'll wake you up in an hour."
He kissed her forehead and walked off. He turned off the lamp that was on the coffee table next to her before making his way into the kitchen. The room was now pitch black and everyone was quiet. She pulled the covers to her until they were up to her elbow. She stared at the ceiling for a moment before clasping her hands together and closing her eyes. She whispered,
and now I lay me down to sleep. I pray, dear Lord, my soul to keep. And if I die before I wake, I pray the Lord my soul to take.
The next thing Evelyn knew, she was walking down the short, narrow hallway in her apartment. She had no memory of how she got there.
"How did I get here?" she asked. "This doesn't feel like a dream. It feels too real. But it has to be."
She could hear and feel everything as if it was actually there. She could feel the carpet fibers between her toes, the wood paneling on the walls as her hand grazed it, and her dark hair brushing against her arms. The room was completely silent, aside from the floorboards creaking with each step she made. Emerging out of the hall and into the living area, Evelyn looked to her left, wondering if she would find Cooper and her friends all settled on the couch. She turned on the lamp and there they were, in their chairs, asleep. She walked over to the chair that faced away from her. Evelyn swept her hands across the cushions until her fingers met Cooper's neck. He didn't move or flinch at all. She heard a creak coming from behind her. Her black hair flipped as she turned, only to find nothing there. She muttered to herself, "Come on, I thought you were scarier than that." Stepping back, Evelyn looked all around her. The living room, the hall, the kitchen right across from her, even the ceiling. But Freddy was not there. "Well, if he won't come to me," Evelyn decided to see if she could bring him out. She thought that, after all, if Freddy was as bad as she heard, the least he could do is prove that he was there.
"Freddy!" she yelled. "Are you here?"
Immediately, Evelyn felt a brush against her neck and hot breath against her ear. In a deep, petrifying voice that could only be Freddy's, what he whispered to her echoed through the whole room.
"I'm everywhere!
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 Everywhere!"
he said to her. Evelyn gasped and turned around to look behind her, but he was already gone. Freddy's words had sent a chill down her spine. Her eyes widened. She returned her gaze back to the floor. She felt her heart beating faster. The thumping of her heart echoed in her eardrums. When she turned, she noticed that the room was completely empty. Cooper was no longer sitting in the chair in front of her. Jill, Faith, and Stephen were also gone. Before Evelyn could calm herself, the floor began to shake. Not violently, but enough for her to take notice. She quickly looked up and no longer recognized her living room. The atmosphere had changed in an instant. All around her, the room was surrounded by dark lights mixing from red to green to purple to blue and back again. She also heard a ferociously loud whirring noise. She couldn't tell where it came from because it seemed to be traveling everywhere. It was horrible and screeching, like something trying to force its way into her world. Evelyn felt something touching her feet and legs. Her eyes darted to the ground where she saw tendrils of black smoke covering the ground and wrapping around her legs like snakes. The tendrils planted her feet to the floor, trapping her. The objects in her apartment, the lamp, her books, her CDs, her pictures, and the silverware in her kitchen began to levitate high above the ground. Evelyn braced herself as the objects began flying at her at high speed. She protected her head by covering it under her arms. Even though she couldn't run, she was able to dodge away from most of them. From the corner of her eye, Evelyn saw a butcher knife in the kitchen flying towards her. She ducked down quickly enough for it to miss her and hit the wall by the front door instead. She gasped and short screams left her mouth as she avoided more. Finally, one of her own books from her bookshelf had hit her hard, knocking her to the ground. She looked at the book that hit her, Something Wicked, This Way Comes by Ray Bradbury. She could feel some blood running down from her nostril, but she didn't bother wiping it off. She saw the wisp of smoke crawling higher up her legs, past her knees, and closer up her thighs. Evelyn struggled to break out of its grip by shaking and jerking her legs. Suddenly, another hover of smoke shot up from the ground. This one had red and green stripes, with four long silver claw-like tendrils pointing at her.
It smacked down and grabbed her left thigh. The tips of the claws left tiny puncture wounds on her leg. Evelyn screamed in pain, still fighting off her captor. She rapidly pushed and brushed the red and green cloud of smoke away from her. Eventually, the smoke had dissipated, and the ground was clear again. Four little ribbons of blood streamed down her leg as she picked herself up from the ground. As she stood up, she heard a low, humming growl. From her hallway, the evil force spawned from the Necronomicon barreled down the narrow halls and closer to Evelyn. The force roared with an unholy growl, its voice growing louder and higher the closer it got to her. The poor young Evelyn, for a moment, was left breathless at the sight of it. Its appearance was inexplicable. She reached for the doorknob and swung the door open. As soon as she did, she saw that there was no outside beyond that door. There was only endless darkness. She turned and saw that the entity was but a few feet away from her. Without a second thought, Evelyn leapt into the dark void to fall for what she thought might last forever. Just until I wake up, she thought. Hopefully, I'll wake up soon. It was a short fall that caused her to land right on top of a small bed in a dimly lit bedroom. She pushed herself up, recognizing the thick, patchy quilt beneath her. She looked all around her as she slowly got up from the mattress. Evelyn remembered the floral wallpaper surrounding every wall, the old mahogany dresser on her right, and the open window next to it that allowed her to gaze outside when she was a child. She was in her old room, the very same one she used to run away to when she was afraid. Of all the places Freddy could have taken her, on a boat surrounded by shark-infested waters, a desert filled with deranged axe murderers, or even hell itself. This was someplace Evelyn never wanted to be. Not again. Because to her, this was hell. For so many years, she was trapped here, left to cower in the corner. She would listen as her father's footsteps became louder, and her body would freeze as she feared that he was walking to her. You bastard! Everything was exactly as she remembered it. Even the closet to her left contained the clothes she used to wear back in her elementary school. Some blouses mixed with sports jerseys, jeans, two dresses shoved in the very back, and a pair of tennis shoes thrown on the floor. Not long after she familiarized herself with where she was, the quiet atmosphere was soon filled with a faint noise. She listened attentively. She could hear it clearly now. Crying. Sniffling, whimpering. Evelyn walked to the end of the room, towards the door. She grabbed the doorknob and turned it, slowly and quietly. Opening the door by an inch or so, she peeked outside in the hall. It was dark, so she couldn't see much. She could only see what the shadows weren't hiding. Evelyn felt cold and nervous, not wanting to know what was on the other side. But she knew she had to in order to go further. It looked like the silhouette of a man peeking out in the hall, but he was immersed in black shadow. His face was not visible, only the direction in which he moved. He stood in front of an open door in the hall just across from where Evelyn was standing. She remembered it. That was her parents' room. After only a second, the man had turned to his right and disappeared into the dark. When he turned away, the entry to the bedroom he had been standing in front of was now revealed to her eyes. Feeling safe enough to go out, Evelyn opened the door just enough for her to slip through and raced across to see what was on the other side. Her body stiffened and she stopped just a few feet from the door when she saw that, sitting in the middle of the bed, was her mother. Mom? Evelyn called to her in disbelief. Her mother was like an older image of Evelyn. She had long, dark hair and had beautiful, full red lips like her daughter. The only difference was in the eyes. Evelyn's eyes were a glimmering emerald color. Her mother's eyes were a grayish blue color. Also, her mother's face had become sunken, with red lacerations across her forehead and cheeks. She wore a white silk nightgown that reached to the bottom of her feet. She had been covered in bruises all the way from the outer corners of her eyes to her arms, and probably more hidden underneath her gown. She sat there, stiffened as tears ran down her face. The woman looked as if she was being held in place by an unseen captor. Her breath was short, like she was being suffocated. Evelyn's mom looked at her, smiling with false reassurance. Don't worry, honey, she said. Mommy's fine. Your dad and I just had a little disagreement.
Evelyn took one step closer, nearing the entrance.
Mom, what did he do to you?
At this point, she herself wasn't sure if he meant her dad or Freddy.
Baby, it's nothing, her mother said. You didn't have to leave home because of what happened.
Evelyn was shocked.
What? How could you leave me, Evelyn?
Tears streamed down her mother's face.
Now I'm all alone. Why could you do that to me?
Evelyn stepped back, horrified.
No, no, she shook her head. This is a dream. You would never say that. You ran away. You left me here to die.
In that instant, four large lash marks raced down from her left shoulder, diagonally to her stomach. Bright crimson blood gushed from her body, covering her white gown in red. Soon after, stab marks appeared on her ribs and arms. She screamed in terror as tears stung her eyes. Evelyn could not see who was doing this to her mom. She could only see cuts happening. Before she knew it, the door had been slammed shut and the hall was quiet. As she slowly stepped back, she hit something with her feet. Something made of glass that rolled and clinked against another glass object. She looked down at the floor and saw that it was strewn with glass containers of tequila, vodka, and beer. Her father's usually nightly drinks. She covered her head with her hands.
This isn't real! This isn't happening!
She forced herself to say. Suddenly, the echo was back again. It started as a whisper.
Evelyn! Called Freddy.
Then a quiet laugh. Finally, in a booming, graveled voice that reverberated both in her mind and in the hall,
Daddy's home!
Her eyes widened. Her stomach dropped. She felt every bone in her body shake. The first thing she thought to do was run. She fled as fast as she could, racing down the hall, through the living room, and finally out the front door into the dark of night. When she escaped out the door, she gazed across the porch, the lawn, and the houses in front of her. She didn't remember this place. She wasn't on her old street anymore. Evelyn stepped down the brick steps and turned around to see the house she had been sent to in her dream. The white paint, the green roof shingles, six windows on both stories, the bright red door and the gold address plate to the right of it, 1428. Evelyn was in front of the house on Elm Street, the very same one dozens of other kids had lived in before, where Freddy caught them in their dreams and murdered them. The same one Freddy himself used to live in and plan his next kill. Her mouth gaped. She couldn't believe her eyes, but now she knew he was real. Evelyn turned around to see three little girls in white, frilly dresses, playing jump rope and singing hypnotically. The more she observed them, she realized something about them was strange, other than the fact that they were singing about Freddy coming to get her. Their voices sounded otherworldly, like they were ghosts of themselves. They moved and jumped slowly, as if in slow motion.
5, 6, grab your crucifix.
She walked closer to the little girls. She looked at their faces, determining that they couldn't have been older than 8 years old. She made a conscious effort to keep a distance between her and the girls. This was a nightmare, after all. She didn't know what might happen next.
7, 8, gonna stay up late.
Their dresses, she thought, they're all ripped and bloody. The ends of their dresses had been frayed with speckles of blood. Some of that blood had dripped down on her white dress shoes.
Oh my God,
she whispered. She felt like she wanted to cry. Freddy did that to them, she realized.
9, 10,
as soon as their song was over, out of nowhere, Evelyn saw Freddy's charred hand reach out from the shadows and grab the rope as it swung to the top, stopping it in mid-swing. Evelyn felt her heart race again. She slowly backed away but kept her eyes locked on him. Freddy emerged from the shadows. First, the sleeve of his ratty red and green sweater came into view.
He stepped forward, allowing Evelyn to see his black work boots and greasy slacks. He didn't show his face at first. As he strode out from the darkness, he kept his head lowered slightly, his brown, wrinkled fedora covering most of his face. He walked closer to Evelyn. He lifted his head, revealing his burnt face. With his left hand, he swiped the brim of his hat. It sat there, crooked, covering the top of his face and concealing one of Freddy's blue eyes, while the other stared straight into hers. Evelyn reacted in a mixture of fear and disgust from the sight of him. She watched him, petrified, as he got closer to her. She didn't know what to do. She could have ran away, but she was in Freddy's world now. It wouldn't have made a difference. Freddy slung the rope over his shoulder and smiled at her. As he grinned, he revealed his teeth. They looked like fangs, sharp, pointed, bloody fangs. He struck his glove in front of her and wiggled the knife blades around, as if he was waving hi to her. She gasped and began to step back as Freddy stepped forward.
"It's true," said Evelyn. "You are real."
But she didn't want it to be true.
"Oh," said Freddy disapprovingly. "Didn't your daddy ever tell you not to go looking for trouble?"
he growled.
"Or was he too busy getting drunk?"
Freddy grabbed the rope and held it end to end with both hands. He laughed maniacally. Evelyn screamed and turned around to run away from him. For a second, she thought she was able to get away, until she felt the rope swing over her neck. She was pulled down to the ground, causing her to lose breath. Freddy wrapped the rope around her neck, constricting and strangling her. He used the last foot of rope to drag her across the lawn. With each tug, Evelyn felt immense pain. She gagged and choked but couldn't breathe. She stared up at the stars, listening to Freddy tell her in a sing-song voice,
"I'm gonna get you. I'm gonna get you. Not another peep. Time to go to sleep."
He stopped when they reached the base of a tree next to the house. Freddy unwrapped the rope around her neck. He grabbed the back of her head and slammed it against the tree. Slam, slam, slam. She coughed up blood and spit it out on the ground. Her forehead was cut and bleeding. She cried as Freddy took the rope and tied her hands by the base of the tree trunk. Evelyn laid on the grass, not able to move her arms. The more she tried, the more the rope would cut and scrape her wrists. Her eyes welled up with tears. She felt hopeless. He kneeled beside her, admiring her scraped, helpless body and her teary face. He flicked one of his razor fingers up and used it to caress her face.
Her sweet little face.
The blade stroked her softly, but he pressed hard enough to make little scratches where he touched her. Then her neck. He watched the sweat slide down her neck as he lingered his blade on her jugular vein. Finally, his razor blade traveled down to her chest. He breathed heavily on her. Evelyn cried. She wanted proof that Freddy was real, and she got her wish. And now she was going to die for it. His blades trailed down her shirt. The razor-like edges cut through the thin cotton of her black Sabbath jersey, shredding it. Her shirt now looked like strings across her chest, leaving only her black bra to cover her. Freddy turned away from her, spread her legs apart, and kneeled over them.
"Next time you see Ash," he growled, "tell him I have a message for him."
Freddy started cutting her inner thigh with his blades. Evelyn shrieked in agony. It felt like she was having surgery done on her without any anesthesia. She felt him slicing her left leg in quick, tiny cuts in different directions. She couldn't see what he was doing, but she could tell he must have been riding something on her leg. She wanted to cry for someone to wake her. She didn't think it would work, but she had to try.
"Wake me up!" she screamed. "Wake me up!"
she screamed louder.
"Please!"
She closed her eyes and sobbed. She felt someone touching her shoulders, lightly pushing her. When Evelyn opened her eyes, she saw Cooper standing above her, looking frightened.
"Evelyn," he asked, "are you okay?"
Thank you.
Okay, Slashaholics, this has been Chapter 13 of Freddy vs. Ash by A.S. Eggleston. Really, really enjoyed this chapter. That nightmare with Freddy, wow. A.S. Eggleston did a great job here with Freddy. He's got just enough, kind of like in The Dream Dealers, just enough of like the MTV Freddy, but a whole lot of Nightmare 1 and 2 Freddy. And I'm really loving the darker Freddy stuff. And boy, it got dark in that nightmare. I don't even know what would have happened if Cooper hadn't woke her up or whatever happened. Definitely looking forward to the next chapter. Let me know in the comments section what all of you Slashaholics thought of this chapter, The Dream. Let me know if you're excited for the rest of it, and I'll be back very soon with more. Until then, this has been your friendly neighborhood 80s Slasher Librarian saying thanks for listening, be excellent to each other, and
pleasant dreams!